Perfect. My name is Maria Simeonidou. I'm an oenologist. I belong to the second generation of the winery. It's a family business. My father takes after the vineyards. My brother studied business administration. He took over the sales part of the winery. And me, I'm an oenologist, as I said. And I'm responsible for the winemaking, for the winery tours, for the wine tastings, for exhibitions abroad and here in Greece, and of course the exports. Also, apart from my work at the winery, I'm a teacher. I teach oenology in a private school for chef students in Kavala. Kavala is the capital of our area, the capital town of our area. It's 10 minutes away from here, from Eleochori. Here is the location of our winery. It's a village near nearby Kavala.
That's cool. Yes, I do this pretty much full time now, working on building the business. And I've had a lot of jobs in my life. Anthony and I met in the Navy years ago, 1999, in fact. I did that for the biggest chunk of my life so far. But I've held jobs from sales and radio to marketing to I've even been an air conditioning repairman at one point. So,
wow.
I've got a lot of jobs under my belt.
Good.
Well, LaFaust here, he's a teacher, yeah. Also.
Can you please repeat? I didn't hear anything.
Gus was mentioned that I'm also a teacher. I'm a adjunct professor up at the American University here in D.C. I teach communications and public relations to many, many, many students.
Perfect. We're both teachers. Different subjects, but both teachers. So I've created a presentation. If you like to share my screen with you.
Yeah.
Shall I go first?
Or do you prefer? Go me? Ladies first.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So, do you see what I see? Do you see the first slide?
Yep.
Perfect. Just a moment. My connection here is a little bit slow. So, I've created this presentation. A portfolio, kind of portfolio for our company products. And let's start. Our principles. We wanted to find a slogan that represents our feelings during the whole process of wine making, from the stage that grapes are born in the vineyard till the stage that wine is bottled. So we get inspired, we respect, we feel, we love, and finally we bottle our soul. Describes exactly all these feelings. Some historical facts. In the ancient times, our area was named Isimi. It's a Greek name, ancient Greek name. Isimi was known for the grapes and the wines, and all of its habitants were cultivating vineyards. These historical facts are known after the discovery of coins on which we find scenes of vine harvest. That's why we know these facts. So now, 60 years ago, in 1950, in Eleochori, as I said, it's the village, it's our hometown and the location of our winery, our grandparents were cultivating grapes and made wine. Today, us, the third generation, we carry on this tradition and we share the same devotion and the same passion for wine. If you have any questions during our presentation, feel free to ask me, okay?
Sure.
Perfect. Are we okay till now? The area. Our winery was founded in 2000. Our own and our cooperative vineyards, we cooperate with local growers here at Eleochori and the widest area of Eleochori. We have 20 hectares in total. And these vineyards are located, as I said, in the widest area of Pangaea Mountain. Gus, do you remember the labels of the wines?
Yeah, the PGI.
That's right, the PGI. The PGI Pangaea. Pangaea is the name of the mountain here in this area. Yeah, that's why this is the appellation of the wines.
Excellent.
That's right. And these vineyards have different altitudes. They vary from 50 to 350 meters. And all these vineyards are under the foothills of Mount Simbolo. The Mount Simbolo is the closest mount near Lahore. And of course we have, you see this picture, this is a Lahore. Do you see my mouse? Okay, this is a Lahore, and this is surrounded by vineyards. All over you see their vineyards, and this is the Aegean Sea and the mountains, as I told you, and from that way we are surrounded by mountains, and especially Mount Simbolo. The terroir. Do you know the term terroir? Have you ever heard that?
I have not.
I'm going to explain you. Terroir refers to the specific conditions of an area. I mean the climate, the weather conditions, the type of the soil, all this kind of stuff that distinguishes an area from another. Here in our area, the combination of Pandia Mountain, of the mountain, and the CNC, these conditions contributes to an excellent climate for viticulture. Here? No. Okay. The land is covered with sand, I'm sorry for that. And as a result, we have mild winters and cool summers due to this, this location and this combination of sea and mountain. The grapes. Why are these conditions considered as excellent for viticulture? Because they're giving high sugar levels and very fine aromas to the grapes we produce. And also we have healthy grapes. I wish you had the opportunity to come at the winery during the harvest time, the harvest period, which is in August till late October. You will have the opportunity sometime, I know, maybe you'll find the way to come here, and you'll see how healthy the grapes are. They're, you see it on the image.
Absolutely.
Absolutely healthy, yeah, that's right. We are proud of our grapes. The philosophy of our common. So, being respectful to the traditional way of vinification, our primary target is to produce wines that reflect the characteristics of our area, the Bangaeon area. So every year, we give all our strength and energy to present our customers exceptional quality wines. This is our goal, our main target, to produce very quality wines. We love wine, so that's why. Winery tours. Our winery is available for tours and visits, and hundreds of tourists, pro-COVID, of course, and wine lovers visit the winery every year. At first, we start with a tour at the winery in the vineyards, and we, of course, explain all the winemaking process with the equipment, with barrels, with the tanks, all this kind of stuff. And we finish with the wine tasting. This is me in the middle. And yeah, we had a wine tasting last year. We hosted, I think, 30 or 35 doctors. Yeah, they loved the whole busy, the whole wine tasting. It was really fun. Any questions so far?
So far, no. This is awesome.
Do you understand everything?
Yep.
Thank you. Okay, let's move on. The wines. We produce 11 different types of wine, both from Greek and international varieties. The appellation, as I said before, Gus, you told me it's PGI, it's Protected Geographical Indication Pangaeo, abbreviated as PGI. And let's start with the wines. White wines first. We produce 6 whites in total, 2 blends and 4 single varieties. The first one is the Hypnos. A Hypnos, it's an ancient Greek name. It means something that smells and tastes very pleasant. It's an ancient Greek name. We don't use it nowadays, but it reflects the wine, the smell of the wine, the aromas and the taste. This is the very first white wine we've ever produced, this one. And this is a blend of 2 Greek varieties, Assyrtiko, the first one, and Malousia. Assyrtiko because it has a rich texture. It has high acidity also. And Malvasia is a more aromatic and more delicate wine. And the blending of them creates perfect wine, full acidity and full aromas. So that's why we chose these particular grapes. From this wine, we produce a little smaller quantity, about 5,000 bottles. At the first paragraph, I describe all the characteristics of the wine, the color. This is a French tank wine that has a pale yellow color, aromas, and the aromas, all this lemon, apple, and peach aromas, depending on the variety each time. And what else? The second paragraph consists of all the information of the winemaking, from vineyards from different altitudes, because we speak about two different varieties, northern faced vineyards give grapes higher sugar levels, and southern faced vineyards give higher acidity to the grapes. So we blend both of them, and as I said, we create perfect wine. The harvest is held at the last on the last 10 days of August for both varieties, and the vinification. Vinification, it's a winemaking terminology. I think, I don't know if you use it at US. I think in England they use it. I don't know, is it common at US?
It's used, it's not super common, but people do use it.
Okay, perfect. So vinification, well, it was held at a constant temperature, a low temperature at 16 degrees Celsius. We keep that temperature because we want to keep the high aroma condensity. So it's better if you have a lower temperature. And we use only the juice from the first rising of the grapes. I mean, we don't use the pressure juice. Of course, if it was stabilized at minus 8 degrees. Sava, come and say hello. No? My brother. Levi, bye-bye. Something, want something? Okay. Okay, I'm going to continue. Sorry for that. So this wine was stabilized at minus 8 degrees Celsius. That means that we use only natural ways, like cooling the wine, and not chemical additions. As I said, guys, we don't use any chemicals. We try to produce wines the more natural we can. We don't use any chemicals. And of course, this wine pairs perfectly with all Greek cuisine. Have you ever tried the Greek cuisine? Of course.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very common everywhere. Fish, of course, shellfish, poultry, white meat. Not so rich dishes, I mean, rich in the mouth with strong flavors and that kind of stuff. Any questions for Idipnos?
No, it's a blend similar to the red blend you have at the same label, the Idipnos
red.
That's
right. That's right. Yeah. You're gonna.
Which you'll get to, I'm sure. Yeah.
Of course, and we're gonna taste them also.
Absolutely.
Idipnos, of course, the red Idipnos. Second one, Sauvignon Blanc. This is a single variety wine. It's a more soft wine in the mouth with delicate aromas like banana, like peach, like lemon, with crystal clarity. And this crystal clarity comes from the cooling, the stabilization, as I said before. We don't use chemicals. And at the second paragraph, I mentioned the yield per vineyard was 600 to 900 kilos per acre. Do you understand what that means?
If you want to explain it, that'd be awesome.
I want to explain. Of course, I'm going to explain. We do what we name green harvest. We reduce the grape load of the vineyard. We cut some quantity of the grapes in order to minimize the leftover grapes, I mean in kilos, and the remaining grapes have a bigger content of aromatic compounds, of sugar, all these kind of ingredients. So we try to take big amounts of aromas and these ingredients. Do you understand this?
Yes.
Is it clear?
I'm clear, yeah.
Okay, perfect. And the food pairing, the Sauvignon Blanc, as I said, is a more soft wine, more delicate wine, and it pairs perfectly with light food dishes like sea salads, like shrimps, crepes, and all this kind of food. The third one, the Sardone, one of the most famous varieties all over the world. Here in Greece, we cultivate, especially in Elefori, we cultivate Sardone for over 30 years. Sardone and Sauvignon Blanc were the first varieties we cultivated here at Elefori. And Cavalla, especially this area we are located, is very known for these varieties, although that they are international. Greek wineries started to cultivate international varieties first, and then we planted the Greek varieties. Because we have a small history of the winemaking. I think it's 30 to 40 years now. But we try our best, and I think we have a good product, of course. So, for the Sardone, also the European Vineyard was 600 to 700. I mention that because if we don't make the green harvest, the yield per vineyard would be 2,000 kilos per acre. It's going to be really heavy, the load of the grapes, and we're going to lose many aromas, many of these compounds and of these substances. The vinification was also all in all the whites we're going to say is the same kind of vinification. The classic white wine vinification at low temperature of 16 degrees. And we use, as I said, only the juice from the first grasping of the grapes. Cold stabilization, as before, and the food pairing. This wine has a more rich texture on the mouth, and it goes with more rich dishes, like grilled seafood dishes. Next one, the Malousia. One of the most famous Greek varieties, not only in Greece, but also abroad. Every winery here in Greece has a Malagousia, type of Malagousia, and the range of the wines. So we planted Malagousia about, 15 years ago. So this variety was just very good at this area. Also small yield per vineyard. Also white wine vinification, 16 degrees, I'm going to say them. I'm sorry, I'm repeating the same things, yeah. But we do in every wine. We don't distinguish the wines. We try to keep high quality in all our wines because we love what we do. We love our profession.
Right.
And this is also, the small Malagousia looks like a Sauvignon Blanc. It's a soft wine, it's a very aromatic wine, and has specific aromas like apricot, like pineapple, and it goes perfectly with sea salad, shrimps, and especially fish, and white meats, but light white meats with no sauces and that's.
This one, if I could just for a second, the Malagousia is my favorite of the batch, and I'm a red wine drinker.
Okay.
What fascinates me is the history of the grape too, the fact that it was nearly extinct, and they brought it back and how it just came roaring back into the wine scene there in Greece. And I think people are really catching on because when I do tastings here, and in the stores that I'm in, this is the one I can't keep. People just love it. They keep coming back for it.
Perfect. Do they like the aroma? They like the taste?
Everything, all of the above, the taste, the fact that it's not overpowering, it's not too sweet, it's not too, it's perfectly balanced, the acid, the aroma, everything is just, I love it.
Me too, I love it too. Okay, let's move on. The next one. Eleostalactos white. We have difficult Greek names. I totally understand you. Every time a tourist comes, wanderers come at the winery, I always explain the Greek names. Eleostalactos means someone that comes from the drop of the sun. Ilios in Greece is the sun. So, Eleostalactos. is our second and last blend of the whites. It's 90% acetico and 10% Sauvignon Blanc. We like the deep nose. We at the place of Malagugia, we put the Sauvignon Blanc. So we have the acetico rich in the mouth, rich in the texture, and we have the smooth Sauvignon Blanc, fine Sauvignon Blanc. We blended together. We created the Gestalactos. As before, the white wine vinification 16 degrees, all this kind of winemaking we do in this wine too. And of course, the food pairing, seafood, shellfish, and meat with white sauce this time, because acetico is a more rich wine and it helps the food pairing with rich substances, foods.
Can I ask a question here? The acetirico grape. Is that one you generally more associated with southern Greece?
That's right. You have a point. I'm very glad you know many things about Greek wine, so I'm very glad. Acetico started from Santorini. It was the place that they cultivated. It started cultivation at Santorini, but we cultivate acetico all over Greece, from North Greece we are located till Crete. Crete is the northern island of Greece. And acetico gives different types of wine. If you try an acetico from Santorini, it's totally different from an acetico from Kavala, from North Greece. Because in Santorini, they use oak, they use maturation in barrels, and use different kind of vinification. That's
why. It's a lot hotter down there too, right?
Yeah, of course, how you done it. And of course, the terroir. The terroir is absolutely the first reason for the different kind of styles of acetico. Okay. I mean, in Santorini they have the hurricane, they have different soil. Yeah, so the terroir is that. It's exactly that. The soil, the climate conditions, and of course, the vinification comes inside the terroir. The how people make the wine. Shall we move on?
Sure.
Perfect. Dacriantelu, you've just bought that wine on your last order. Dacriantelu, also a Greek name, it means the tear of the vine. Yeah, this was inspired from my father, who was the instigator of these names. Yeah, because he's the founder of the winery and he's thought of these names. It means the tear of the vine. This wine is the Chardonnay, like the Chardonnay I've mentioned before, but this time we have a 4 months maturation in French oak barrels. Because we wanted a different type of Chardonnay, we have the fresh tan Chardonnay, and we wanted a matured Chardonnay, an oak Chardonnay. Because Chardonnay, for if we see it as a single variety, the oak helps it and makes it more interesting sometimes. And of course some other varieties, especially for Chardonnay, French oak and oak in general works perfectly. I mean, if as years go by.
It's a very complex but in sort of a subtle way. I noticed you kind of have to really be searching, but man, I really enjoyed that one as well. That was a really good one.
I'm glad. Okay, and what else? The same kind of vinification. I don't mention in that slide. And I describe in small French oak barrels for as many months as it takes for an excellent wine to be created. Why do we write that? Because we've made many experiments for this wine. I remember one harvest and one vintage, I think it was 2009, if I remember good. We've left the wine in barrels for 12 months. It was interesting. And we're trying, and I think the last years we keep it only 4 months because we don't want the oak to be the main taste and the main aroma at the wine. We want also to keep the fruit, like lemon, like citrus, and pineapple, and all of these kind of fruits that Chardonnay gives in our area. So, we finish with the whites. Shall we go with the reds, or do you have something else to ask me?
I'm good. I'm ready to talk about red.
Mm-hmm. Let's start with the red ones. Four reds, two blends, and two single varieties. This one, the Merlot, is one of the single varieties. Also very famous variety all over the world. Also, we cultivate this variety for over 30 years in this area. It is adjusted perfectly. It gives perfectly healthy grapes. And the characteristic aromas are forest fruit aromas, like plums, like cherries. And of course, all the reds have maturation in the oak barrels. And that's why we have mocha and coffee aromas. It comes from the aging process. Also, we give a green harvest in these vineyards, 600 to 850 kilos per acre. And red wine vinification, this time at a little bit higher degrees, 20 degrees Celsius, with a long fermentation time. Do you know the difference between a red wine vinification and a white wine vinification?
Doesn't it have something to do with the using the skins?
And that's right, good. I'm glad that you know so many things about wine. The red wine vinification, we keep the skins with the juice, with the must, for the terminology of the juice, for the fermentation time. As long as we leave the skins with the juice, with the must, the more color we'll get at the wine. So we have a dark red color for this wine. 12 months maturation in spring soak barrels. And I didn't mention anything about the serving. Okay, you know that. It's a tulip glass, of course. It's a specific glass for the wines, for the red wines, bigger than the whites. And of course, the tannins of the red wine pair perfectly with the proteins of the meat. And that's why we have the perfect food pairing, roasted red meat and poultry. Idipnos. It was the white, now it is the red. Also a blend, 50-50, Cabernet Sauvignon with a Merlot, and also green harvest at the same levels, red wine vinification, the same things like before. Though we have now the two different varieties. Cabernet Sauvignon is a more tannic, if I can say it like that, a more tart grape variety. It has a lot of tannins, and Merlot also has tannins, but less tannins and smoother tannins. We blend them together and we make this wine. Of course, it has 12 months for French oak maturation in French oak barrels, because we want it to be smooth inside, in the mouth. This tannins has somehow been more pleasant, and that's why we use the oak. Mm-hmm. And of course, food pairing, roasted meat and poultry. Aegis Stalactos, the second blend, 50% Merlot, 25% Cabernet Sauvignon, and 25% Syrah. Syrah is one of my favorite varieties. It has specific aromas, it has very fine tannins. If you take this wine and put it inside the barrel, it gives you a perfect smooth red wine with full body and rich in the mouth with fine tannins. Red wine vinification this time also, 20 degrees, also the same kind of food pairing, meat and poultry. And Petsavia. Gus, did you get the approval from the customs
for Petsavia? I will have it next time for the next order. Perfect. I would like to try this one, yeah.
Because I wanted to send you Petsavia to try it. It really needs to be tried. I think you should try this one. It's a perfect wine. I love it. And this, not only me who creates the wine, but also the tourists. They
absolutely
love it. The Americans, they love it. I don't know, the Americans drink mostly white or red.
Oh, sure. I think it depends on who you talk to.
That's right.
It seems like people are pretty picky about their whites over here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the reds are kind of, everybody's a little more willing to experiment with. Mm-hmm. That's just what I've noticed anyway.
Okay. So, Petravia has a double meaning. Petra in Greece means the rock. Petravia means the jewelry, the precious stones. So it has double meaning because the vineyard, this wine is made from a single vineyard. The vineyard has stones inside its soil. So that's why we have a double meaning. Petravia also the precious stone. It means that the wine is very precious, very rare. It's, if we can say it, how we can say it perfectly. Okay, I'm going to find it later. It's a deep dark red and honey-like color. It, of course, from the oak maturation. Full-bodied, as I said, with very, very, very fine tannins. It's like velvet tannins. Forest fruit aromas. These are the aromas of the variety of the Syrah. And as I said before, the vineyard, nowadays, is only one vineyard that we use for this wine, our private vineyard. And very, very low yield per hectare. I think it was per acre, sorry. It was 600 to 700 kilos. Mm. It's really low. I want to understand, that if we don't make green harvest, it can reach 2,000 kilos. It's really high. So we want to make quality wines, and that's why we do the green harvest.
Sure.
Of course, maturation in French oak barrels. We use French. We are fans of French. We used American oak before, but I think that French oak, it pairs more perfect with these kind of varieties. These are French varieties, mostly.
We won't take that personally.
No, please don't.
It's funny you say that because about maybe 15 miles from where I live is one of the biggest oak producers in America, over in Minnesota. That they produce American oak there. So, but they send them for like whiskey barrels and things like that.
Not they don't use it for wine.
Not so much. The guys down in Tennessee really keep them busy with their whiskey, so mm-hmm. I think they're okay.
okay. Maybe in Oregon or in Napa Valley.
Yeah.
Who knows? What did they say? Oh, the maturation of the French oak barrels. For us, many months, like the Criabello, the tier of the vine. And, of course, the food pairing this time also meets the tannins of the red, meet the proteins of red meat or poultry. And finally, the rosé. I'm writing here semi-dry. I don't remember if you, I think that you have the semi-sweet kind of rosé. Am I right?
The coquinofili.
That's right, the coquinofili. Coquinofili means red kiss.
I did know that.
Yeah, you know that, perfect. So this time at this vintage, that's 2020, we wanted to make a semi-dry coquinofili because I don't know why. Here in Greece, they prefer it semi-dry. Mm. And here in Greece, we have big quantities for the needs of the market. And that's why we turned it to semi-dry this year. We'll try that and I can tell you the results. For this wine, we have only one rosé. You see that? The first part, prominent, fine, flavorful, a product made for discerning people and for those who feel young and will be young forever. It's a wine that can be consumed all time long, in wintertime, in summertime, alone, with food, in a wine bar, in a restaurant, everywhere. And this wine is a blend of two varieties, Muscat of Alexandria and a little bit of Merlot, just for the color, because Muscat of Alexandria is a white variety. Muscat has a very particular aroma. It looks like roses. It looks like red fruits, especially roses, if you ask me. And the vinification was the classic rosé vinification. The rosé vinification, it's familiar with the white vinification, the same degrees, and the same kind of cooling stabilization. Do you understand what stabilization is? Do you want me to explain it to you?
Stabilization, that's just getting to clarify it, correct?
Clarify, that's right. In order to not settle down any sediments from the whole process. That's right. We could do that by adding chemicals. It will last only for 2 hours, but we prefer the hard way, 1 week, the cool stabilization. And I think that's the best part of all this vinification.
Right.
And of course, this wine pairs perfectly with red fruit salads, with cheese, with poultry. Yesterday, I drank this wine with pizza. Mm. I think it goes perfectly with sweet pastries and this kind of food.
I like it with spicy food.
Yeah, that's right. Because it has really sweet good. Inside. Yeah, it has sugars. That's right. Yeah. With spicy food, perfect. Thank you for mentioning that. Yeah. I'm going to say the next time. Some information about us. You already know them, of course. And thank you very, very much for your attention. I hope you're not tired.
No, that was very good. A little, just a note personally from about the Coquino Fili. A lot of people over here are real skittish about their rosés too. They can either be really picky, like they have their one brand, or they don't like it at all because they say it tastes too sugary or too sweet. Even the semi-sweet though that you sent me, it blows people's minds when I taste it because, like you said, I always tell them, to me it smells like rose water and honey. Is what it smells like to me, and how it's almost like eating a candied apple when you're drinking it, but it's not overly sweet. It's and this is coming from a guy who likes his who likes his whiskey and red wine. That is to me one of the most surprising ones that you sent me was that one.
Okay, good. So well, what about you, your presentation? Oh.
Sure. Mine's not quite as long or as in detailed as yours, but it will give a kind of a high level of what we do over here. Let me see where. Man, and we practiced this earlier, how to share my screen.
it's the button near there it is. The conversation button. Yeah.
There we go. So, do we got it?
Yeah.
Okay, yes. So we're Aris Global Imports. We named it, we wanted a Greek sounding name, to be honest. Mm-hmm. It was a marketing choice. Neither Lefaus or I are Greek, but we wanted to kind of do a little nod in respect to the country because that's who we're dealing with. I think it's really, especially because up in northern Greece, I know Thessaloniki has a football club. Named Aris, and so that's where that came from.
That's right.
We're a two-man outfit right now. Myself, Gus, and Anthony Lefaus, who's with us on here. We met, like I said, in 1999 when we reported to U.S. Navy boot camp together, and I haven't been able to get rid of him since. That's the basis here. We decided to go into business not long ago, actually. You know, what was it, last fall or no?
Yeah, last fall.
This is a picture of La Crosse. We're located right on the Mississippi River. This is the big famous bridge.
It looks really fantastic. Sorry, interrupting, but it looks fantastic. The image, yeah.
Oh, yeah. and then I had to put a picture of Wisconsin winter in here, just because I think everybody should have to experience it at least once, at least somehow. This is downtown, facing down Main Street, and that's our big cathedral here in town. But we are based here in La Crosse. Our goal, like I said, is we want to bring fine foods here to an area of, it's starting to get better in this area. And with people wanting to try new things. But I think when people think of wine, they think of Italy or France or Napa. And that's one of the things we're really trying to change, is there's so many great growing regions, and particularly in Greece, where, you know, the stuff, this is where it comes from. You know, some of the oldest grape pressings come from Greece, thousands mm-hmm. and thousands of years ago. So why wouldn't the people that darn near invented it know a thing or two about it? And I think people are starting to catch on, but that's what we're going for. This community is based, you know, it's my hometown. It's where I've you know, grew up. My family lives here. We have really deep roots in this community. We're a small company, but we want to take the proceeds and the benefits of doing business with other countries and with other people, and turn it into something positive in our community and the communities of others. So apart from being my hometown, it's centrally located near three major metro areas, which is Minneapolis, St. Paul, Minnesota, Chicago, Illinois, and then Milwaukee, which is here in Wisconsin. The Chicagoland area, which actually includes Milwaukee, is the third largest Greek American community in the United States. So we're having a lot of positive response down there, which hopefully soon will turn into some really good community down there. I'm working with the consulate general down there in Chicago, who out of there is the office of the Trade Commission, and his name is Dimitris, and he's such a really, really nice guy, and he's really helping.
I remember you said his details. Yeah,
that's right, I sent you his info. He's been really positive. When I introduced myself to him, he said, you know, I always get calls from Greeks in America wanting, or Greeks from Greece wanting to do a business in America. I never get calls from Americans. So he's been just great about bending over backwards to help me out and to help us out and with anything we need, making contacts and what have you.
Mm-hmm.
This is a map. I'm not sure how familiar you are with the United States.
I've taken it on Google Maps. Yeah.
Well, this is Wisconsin, and the red star there is La Crosse. And as you can see, it's pretty centrally located. Just to give you an idea, to drive from here to Chicago is about 5 hours. Milwaukee is about 3 hours. Mm-hmm. And Minneapolis-St. Paul is about two and a half. So it's driving is some, you know, it's something we're used to over here. It's not a big deal. So all of these are well within our marketing range. Currently, we're only licensed to sell in Wisconsin. Licensing for alcohol is really weird here in the United States. If I were to sell in another state, any of the other 50 states, I would have to be, I'm considered an exporter at that point. So we are working on making inroads and finding distributors in those other states to make it easier. But that's, right now there's more than enough business here in Wisconsin to keep us busy for quite some time.
I'm going to ask you one question. In which states do you sell the wines? Only at Wisconsin because of the license?
Correct.
Okay.
And that's something, like I said, we're working on. I've been in contact with several distributors in Minnesota and Illinois. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of licensing involved with that, so we have to have... it's really complicated to get into on how the different states work with their alcohol licensing. It's frustrating, but we're working on it. And once we can get into those bigger cities, that's going to be something really big, I think.
So we have two goals for the two states, the Wisconsin and the Illinois, these two states. Your goals,
For goals will be...
Your ideal goal for selling the wines.
Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Illinois. Yes.
Okay. Good. I think they're two big states.
Oh yeah.
They have so many places to sell the wine.
Right.
Yeah, and we call Chicago here in the United States the second city, referring to New York as being the first city.
Okay.
But Chicago is that big of a market that we actually call it the second city, and it's basically the gateway to the Midwest. So most of our beef production and commodities all actually travel through Chicago because it's centrally located on Lake Michigan. So you can actually import directly to Michigan. It's on the Mississippi. So you can start to send things up and down. And it's actually, I think, the second largest train hub in the United States. So all of our commodities like wheat, grain, potatoes, all of them actually flow through the city. So it's it is a prime target if we can get into that state with regulations.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's when we import, it comes from New York and lands in Chicago, and then they actually ship it to me from Chicago to La Crosse. So
okay.
As long as it's already there, so that is our bigger goals.
Okay.
Here in the United States. Being a veteran-owned business is a big deal, and we are 100% veteran-owned. Like I said, we were both in the Navy. I was in for 12 years, and what were you, four or five?
4 years, yeah.
4 years. So we are 100% veteran-owned business, and what we're working on is channeling our profits into our communities and the communities of our suppliers. So I don't know if I brought that up with you yet, Maria. But what we would like to do is talk with our suppliers. We also we're bringing in oil from Crete right now, and we want to talk about how we can make donations or whatever. If there's a like charitable organizations or what have you that can benefit those of our suppliers, because we know that without our suppliers we don't have a business, and. As our business grows, those types of donations and charitable actions can be more helpful, which is why we're trying to make it beneficial for everybody. So as we move forward, that's something I will be reaching out with you about, is talking with, is there something that in your area that needs action. It's something that's very important to both of us. On our end, we're using the Anthony Foundation. It's named after my son. He was a victim of violence last summer, and so we've decided to turn the tragedy of his death into something that can be positive for the community. So like I said here, we're dedicated to promoting kindness and helping wherever there's need. So there's plenty of organizations here in our city that need help. And we want to do that in his name to make it, to make it worth something.
Yeah.
And so that's what that is. We're in the middle of filing paperwork to become a, there's all sorts of legalese I could bore you with about becoming an actual charitable organization. But just suffice to say, right now we're taking those steps to become a force for good in the area.
Mm-hmm.
So and this is us. I'm the good looking guy on the left. just so you can see, Anthony, his company, would you say that's an actual professional picture, which I'm really jealous of.
A lot of Photoshop to touch that up. Let me tell you, lots of touch-ups.
Well, but yeah, so just so you can get a clear picture of us and put names with faces and things like that. That's us.
Okay, good. Perfect.
That's really all I have. Without getting too deep into what we have, that's us in a nutshell.
Perfect.
Then are we back to normal now?
No, we get the mirror thing. You're still sharing your screen.
Okay, let me see. Stop sharing. There it is. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Anything else you'd like to discuss?
No, I guess if you wanted to take us through a couple of the wines, that would be great.
Yeah, perfect. I have all of them